I'm going to talk about dynamic auto-optimizing framework for GPU applications in this talk. And I'll start with talking a little bit about the GPU execution model. So generally, yeah, see? Colors, anyway. So the GPU can be thought of as a, basically as a wide SIMD machine, and computational functions that run on the GPU, which are actually called kernels, usually are launched with hundreds and thousands of threads. And these threads are grouped into thread blocks. And the thread blocks can execute independently and are scheduled on the SMs that are available on a GPU device. So if a GPU device has more SMs, then you can run more thread blocks in parallel and get better performance. Now, these thread blocks are further divided into warps. And a warp, in NVIDIA terminology, can be thought of as the smallest schedulable entity on the GPU. So threads within a warp run in parallel in lockstep fashion. And I'm giving you all this background because it's kind of going to be important when I talk about some of the optimizations. So that's kind of how the execution model goes. I want to say something about the GPU memory hierarchy as well, because GPU does have a tiered hierarchy of memory. And the two two types of memories that I want to point out is shared memory and global memory. So this work was done for discrete GPUs where the global memory is actually off-chip, but the shared memory is on-chip, so it has a much lower latency, and it's shared by all the threads within a thread block. But in the case of global memory, because it's off-chip, the GPU hardware allows for memory accesses to be coalesced. And what that means is that if threads within a warp are accessing memory that is sequential or contiguous locations of memory, then those accesses will be coalesced into a single transaction. And that really improves the memory bandwidth for global memory. So to highlight, really, there's two well-known performance limiters on the GPU. One is irregular control flow, because you have massive number of threads, and what happens when these threads take different paths on the GPU, but also irregular global memory access patterns, which is what I explained, that if threads are not working on contiguous elements, then you end up with a lot more transactions than necessary. This is for threads within a warp. In this work, I'm going to primarily focus on the global memory, in this talk, global memory access patterns, but the paper has some details about the irregular control flow as well. So the basic goal or kind of the premise of this work is that optimizing GPU code is really hard today, and it should be and can be made easier, and that there's some level of automation and runtime mechanisms that we can do to make this better, and that's the solution that we're going to try to propose. So first of all, why is it so hard today? It's because GPU codes usually require these very architecture-specific optimizations. So given a workload, you may find that certain workloads really benefit from using shared memory and others don't. But even for the same workload, you may find that for a given input, you apply a certain optimization and it does really well. But for another input, that same optimization does not do so well. So there's this, manual fine-tuning and, lots of permutations of optimizations you have to look at, and you need a lot of expertise. So the state of the art is that usually GPU algorithms have multiple code versions, some suited for this kind of input, some suited for this kind of that's kind of how it is today. The situation is worsened by the fact that there's a trend towards generality where we want to apply GPU computing for general purpose applications. So these applications were not necessarily suited to the very regular data parallel model of the GPU, but now can benefit in some ways because they have either regions of code that are really well suited for the GPU, for example, or data parallel. And we're trying to run these workloads on the GPU because it's available and the GPUs are pervasive. So here, what the point really is that even if you do programmer tuning for these input-dependent behaviors, it's not really going to be helpful to do that statically. You have to figure out how to do it dynamically so that you can react to the changing inputs and the changing behaviors of the application. So finally, another trend is that we have seen a plethora of high-level front ends for GPUs, and this is really to make programming easier for GPUs. I kind of showed you the architecture, and so as you can imagine, exploiting all those features makes programming very difficult for GPUs. So we have these high-level front ends such as Dandelion, Delight, and many others that are trying to improve programmer productivity by providing another abstraction on top of the GPU, programming language. But then, because you have another abstraction, many of these frameworks are not performant at this point because you know, they don't really deal with these architectural optimizations. So the nice thing, though, is that because it's a high-level frontend, it does generate the GPU code on the fly. So it makes it easier for a runtime to come in and perform the optimization dynamically. And that's really what this work is. We call it Leo, but it's really an automated performance framework for GPUs where we integrate an instrumentation framework with a high-level frontend to provide a runtime that can do optimizations on the fly and reduce the amount of fine-tuning and manual tuning that programmers have to do. So let me talk about the specific optimization that we're looking at. I'll give you an example or sense of it. And this is a well-known optimization on the GPU, actually. It's a data layout transformation. So if you imagine a a structure with several, you know, member fields, and you imagine that each thread basically works on one instance of this structure. So when you have multiple threads, it works on different instances of this structure. The way it would be laid out in memory, if you just do a direct mapping, then the members of a structure will be contiguously laid out. So when different threads are working on different members, their accesses would not be sequential. They would be spread apart. This would then mean that when it's trying to fetch this or access this data from global memory, it would end up being that for four threads accessing like four members, you'd end up with 16 global memory transactions in the GPU with this layout. So a very common optimization is to change this layout from row major to column major, where you actually end up putting all the members together so the threads can access sequential memory locations. And now, given the GPU architecture, you are able to coalesce, and this ends up now the same, you know, ends up having only four transactions as opposed to 16 because of the benefit from coalescing. So this is what the optimization looks like. It's pretty well known that GPUs can benefit from this optimization. So what I'm going to now go into is give you a concrete example of how this optimization sometimes works and sometimes doesn't for a given workload. So here we have a given concrete application called SkyServer. And what SkyServer does is it takes a collection of large amounts of astronomical data from two different collections, like photos and their neighbors, and performs a series of equijoin operations on them, and then does some filtering on that data. So here we kind of show the join and the join predicate and the where predicate on how this works as a simplified diagram. But what I really just want to show is that you have these two separate collections, photo objects and neighbors, and then the join predicate, depending on your initial input, the join predicate could produce many matches and therefore have high selectivity or produce few matches. And these are two different kinds of inputs. So that's what I'm trying to just highlight here. So let's look at the behavior for these two different kinds of inputs and this data layout transformation that I talked about. So we're going to perform these this array of structure to structure of array transformation on these two distinct inputs. Input one has low selectivity for the join predicate, and input two has high selectivity. And what we end up seeing, I present the aggregate kernel runtime, so lower is better in terms of performance. What we end up seeing is for input set one, the optimization was helpful, but for input set two, it actually degraded performance. And this is not what we expected, because clearly it improved the number of transactions that were required to get to access that data. So digging deeper, what we found out, the reason behind this was that although we improved the global memory access, the global memory efficiency, we ended up degrading the cache by doing this. So when you imagine these large data structures and they have high selectivity, when threads access like the first members, right, and you can reduce the number of transactions required to get that data, but then when they access the next members, if they're not in cache, then you have to go fetch those, right? But in the first case, because those members were located close by to each other and the selectivity was lower, they actually ended up fitting in the cache. So you didn't have to worry about the memory transactions in that situation because it was all in the cache. So this is something that basically just kind of shows the interaction between global memory and cache and how that can play in. That even for a well-known optimization, you cannot just assume that it will just always do well. It's really input dependent. And it really calls out for a solution that could do this more dynamically And that's what we want to propose. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the solution and then present some experimental results, related work, and conclude with some next steps. So for the proposed solution, what we really first want to do is be able to characterize an application, basically in some way be able to tell dynamically how it's performing. And so the way we do this is by using dynamic instrumentation, and then we use the results from the instrumentation to drive the runtime optimization. And the current focus, the focus of this work is on this GPU memory efficiency data layout transformation. So here's at a high level, an application here can be considered as consisting of several GPU functions that you know, are constructed as a data flow graph. And so the first thing we do is we generate the GPU kernel using our compilation framework, or retrieve it if it's already been generated. And then we analyze, instrument, and execute the kernel on the GPU backend. We get the instrumentation profiling results, and we identify which data structures we want to be able to optimize using taint analysis. And then we apply the optimization to those candidates. This is all happening in the first iteration, or you can say this is like, usually these applications are iterative. They perform the same operation on several chunks of data. So on the first chunk of data, we perform this. And then we iteratively then keep, we look at the performance of our optimized layout versus the original layout to figure out if it was beneficial to do that, and then choose the more optimal layout for that, for the remaining you know, chunks of that application. So it turns out that my prior work was to build a dynamic instrumentation for GPUs, and that's GPU links. And we had Dandelion, which was a front end, which is a compiler runtime that provided us exactly with what we needed in terms of being able to build this together. So the idea was, well, let's put these systems together and develop this optimizing runtime. So just to kind of summarize, GPU Links is an instrumentation engine which provides customized and selective profiling for GPU applications, and also allows for control flow and data flow analysis. So we can do things like taint analysis and other things that I'm going to use in this work. And Dandelion is a heterogeneous compiler and runtime for GPUs, which cross-compiles C# .NET code into GPU code and provides a natural interface for us to be able to do these optimizations at runtime. So a little bit on Dandelion. This is kind of how you would write your high-level link query, for example, just like, you know, you would write it without worrying about whether there's a GPU or not. And then the Dandelion compiler would generate it as a data flow graph, and for each of the nodes would generate the corresponding GPU code. This is what Dandelion gives us as an infrastructure. GPU links takes each of those CUDA kernels, or, you know, GPU kernels, and also takes an instrumentation specification that you can specify in a C, in C. And that instrumentation specification is, what are you instrumenting, right? And in our case, we're trying to measure the global memory accesses and whether they're aligned or not in memory. So we write the instrumentation. And so then what GPU links does is it extracts the intermediate language, which is called PTEX for NVIDIA, and inserts the instrumentation code at that layer, and then executes it, generates a new instrument PTEX, which then can be executed on the GPU backend. This is what, just to give a summary of what Lynx does. So let's see how all of this kind of works together in terms of the instrumentation flow. We start with a link query, we generate a data flow graph, we generate the GPU code from it, we extract the IR, the PTEX kernel, from it. Now here, like in this example, for example, we're doing a join on like two data structures, A and B. But it might be that one of them doesn't need a memory layer, doesn't need a transformation because it has high memory efficiency. So what we do is we do taint analysis to associate global memory accesses to the corresponding parameter. So in this case, we know that, you know, the first load operation is associated with the data structure A, and the second one is associated with data structure B. So then when we actually instrument it and execute that, and we learn that the memory efficiency, whatever it is, in this case we might find that A has 100% efficiency, so we don't really need to do anything to it. But we improve, but we perform the data layout transformation on just candidate B because it had a lower memory efficiency, and we wanted to improve that. So this is kind of how the instrumentation flow works. How does this fit into the larger profiling framework? So I kind of mentioned about we need three iterations. The first iteration to do the instrumentation, second iteration to measure the optimized layout, and the third one to measure the original. So that's what I show here. The first iteration, basically the steps that I just showed you, that the instrumentation steps, take the link application, generate the data flow graph, the GPU code, instrument it, execute that on the GPU. Then for the next one, use the instrumentation results, generate the optimized kernels, execute that on the GPU. And finally, for the third iteration, simply execute the original binaries that you had. And then we can measure that the runtime for the transformed kernels to the original kernels and choose the more optimal layout for this particular input for all subsequent chunks of that data. So that's how the profiling framework, this is how the profile-guided optimization works. So I'm going to now move on to the results for some of the applications that we evaluated. And so what the table is trying to show is the profile-guided speedup, which is using our framework, requires no code changes. It's automatic. There's nothing that any the programmer has to do. Versus the Oracle, which is if we knew upfront what the best layout is for for each of those applications, and we didn't do any instrumentation and profiling and just applied it, that's what we would get from the that's the end-to-end performance gain we would get from the original application, the way it was running. So now, one thing that I want to highlight that some of these numbers, they may not look that high, 7%, 9%, and the reason is that we're just really optimizing the kernel runtimes, but I'm showing end-to-end performance. So this performance includes the amount needed to actually move the data from the CPU to the GPU, and since this work was done on discrete GPUs, that's usually the bigger cost. So that's just something to note, that we believe that if we did this on integrated GPUs, where those overheads were in general much lower, we would see a much, much higher benefit. The other thing to note is that the overall performance impact does vary with workloads. Because we did a memory optimization, you would expect that memory-bound workloads will benefit more, whereas like Black-Scholes and K-means are compute-bound workloads. They don't do that many memory operations in the first place, so the benefit is proportional to that. But the main and interesting point is that Sky Server, with these two different inputs, where one, the optimization helps and the optimization does not, gets a pretty good benefit, 34 to 42% from our framework. And this is and the programmer pretty much does nothing in this whole scenario. It doesn't have to do anything. This whole framework just does it for the programmer. So the difference between like 52% versus 34%, I mean, that's the overhead. Like, we do have a 10 to 15% overhead right now for doing the profiling and the instrumentation. And there are ways that we think we can significantly improve that. We can do more selective instrumentation and profiling and things like that we did not actually investigate when we did this work. But this is just to show that at least it's possible to get better performance even without requiring manual hand tuning. So just a quick summary and related work. Profile-guided optimizations have been studied extensively. We really just apply it to GPU programming. High-level GPU language front ends, we obviously exploit one of them, Dandelion. There are several out there. And we're not restricted to work under Dandelion, but the ideas can be applied to any of these front ends. Irregular workloads, there's a nice study on how GPU applications are irregular in terms of memory efficiency and control flow. So we got a lot of the ideas of which applications to target from that work. And GPU optimizations, such as the one I showed you, have also been studied very extensively. So our contribution isn't really to say that this optimization is good for the GPU. We know it is, or we know that it is in some cases. But it's really to show that in spite of that, there's input dependence, there's dynamic behavior. How can we judge whether an optimization is good or not? And that's what the profiling framework is trying to show. So in conclusion, we pretty much took all of those related work and put them together to build a dynamic auto-optimizing GPU runtime. And hopefully I convinced you that it is possible and there's some profitability to do this way. Of course, for future work, we'd like to be able to do this for more GPU optimizations, just not just the memory layout transformation. But you can do control flow irregularity, shared memory usage, register pressure. There's many kinds of optimizations that can be done that can be investigated with this. And not just that, we also want to build a more comprehensive runtime that not only does optimizing, but can also do dynamic resource management for these integrated CPU-GPU components. So you can dynamically decide where a computation should run, whether on the CPU and GPU. And then when you've selected your device, you optimize for that device. So if we can put it all together, it'll be more comprehensive and more complete, in our opinion. So that's it. I guess I finished a little early, but thank you.
It's a nice talk.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm curious to know about the L1 cache hit rate motivation data.
Mm-hmm.
I see there is a, I mean, maybe it's true, but I don't know. There is a significant difference between the, I mean, the improvement in the L1 cache miss rate and the difference in the performance. Are you sure that it's just because of L1 cache miss hit rate or something else?
I wasn't really trying to show it's just because of that. Because it's kind of hard to say if it's just because of that. There's another aspect that I didn't talk about that I know does impact, which is the way the join is implemented. It is implemented in the GPU. You know, it's implemented as like a hash join, and so there's some irregularity that happens there with control flow, and that also accounts to the performance. But what we were able to see is that. The data was fitting in the cache, and that seemed to indicate that, I mean, for that input set. And so that seemed to be a very strong reason of why.
Thank you.
So I was just curious, what chance would there be of having the compiler, which after all is generating the code, do some amount of compile time analysis that might lead to an insight about how the layout should be done?
Yeah, so we do some of compile time analysis to determine like which candidate structures we choose. But I guess I do agree that actually there's some work that has been done where you can do a better job of making some guess of whether, you know, the problem is that at least at compile time, like the impact that happened on the cache, we couldn't see that, mm-hmm. right? So. In terms of our optimization, you can validate this optimization will definitely improve efficiency. We don't need to necessarily run it that way. But how does it impact these other subcomponents? We won't know that until we run it at runtime. And that's kind of the interaction piece that really led to this kind of insight that we didn't have earlier. But that said, I do think that some of these integrated GPUs are now going to expose or may be able to expose counters to measure the cache while. And that would significantly alleviate some of
that.
Thank
you. It's a very nice talk.
Thank you.
Thanks for the nice talk.
Thank you.
So I've seen very similar things done in parallel loops about optimizing cache performance, things like layouts or everything else. And I've noticed that you're using a data flow programming model. And I was wondering if you could comment on a data flow parallel programming model versus a data parallel model where you have parallel loops or maps, which one would be easier to kind of make these sort of decisions at compile time, or if there are trade-offs, what are the trade-offs?
So I actually don't think it's, we can do this kind of profiling even for applications that are not data flow oriented, but what the data flow kind of orientation gives us is an abstraction to generate these kernels easily. So it's more of just the fact that you can generate multiple code versions easily. But it's not tied to it having to be data flow. If you could do that in a data parallel way in a language, that's fine. But if you think about it like in OpenCL and CUDA, it's actually not that easy to do that because you're at a lower level. If you can do it from a higher level, then yeah, it won't have an impact. But I think the data flow captures that nicely for you, so you could generate certain kernels differently in that flow graph without having to, generate all of it, or you can do parts of it. Versus that's the one advantage that you get from that.
So, thank you.
For the machines that you're using in the work, what is the data width in bits over which the memory coalescing happens automatically?
So, in bits, I know it's at a half warp level, so it's 16 threads, and I think it's 8 bytes. 256 bytes would be the line. The cache line, I guess, I think 8 times 16. I think it's around that. Yeah.
Okay, so that if in fact you have more worker bees, that can be represent a higher load on the coalescing machine, and thus get you not quite as much performance as you would hope for, compared to having fewer workers.
Yes, that's true.
So that's another case where dynamic choice of, well, what machine do I have today?
Exactly. Okay, I see what you're saying. Yeah, I mean, actually, it does vary between like AMD GPUs and NVIDIA GPUs. So you're right. Absolutely.
Thank that's you. True.
That's a good point. And we haven't really looked at, because you know we had built the framework looking at one optimization at a time. But you're absolutely right. If you combine a couple of optimizations, then how does being able to detect what it, what the cause of the performance gain or loss was is going to become more complicated. So the one thing that I can say on that is it is possible to kind of try to do some of the like two or three good primary optimizations one at a time without impacting the, I mean, I know there's the instrumentation overhead, but it is possible to do that if we get some better kind of counters exposed at the IR level, because that will really improve the instrumentation. But you're right. Otherwise, if you try to put three of them together, then it would be difficult to understand. Yeah. So
thank you.
Thank you.